So I have 3 points for us today. In literary terminology, if you were an English major, you may have heard the term ARC. It's an acronym that I'm using today, but ARC is how the hero of the story goes from this place and the process of change that happens in that person's life till they get to that point. And here's my prayer, is using this acronym ARC, I pray that you and myself would understand how to recognize God's call, that we would see how God would want to change us, to bring us to a point where he is able to do something tremendous in us. And so just 3 letters you have to remember, ARC. And the first one, jumping right into it, is availability. And I know this isn't very profound, and we're going to digest and we're going to take apart this Acts chapter 13, 1 verse 5. But here's the thing that happened in Saul's life, happened in Barnabas's life. There was this growing committedness to faithfulness, being available. Look at this is a simple thing. I get it. We all know this, but I don't know if it really penetrates ourselves and our hearts. But there is typically no understanding of God's call on our life if there is no availability, a growing commitment to faithfulness. The principle that you see over and over in the New Testament, throughout scriptures actually, is this idea that God is looking for faithfulness in small things. One of my favorite parables is Matthew 25, and the parable of the talents. The talent is a unit of money, but in it, this wealthy man goes away and he gives one of his servants 5 talents. Another 2 talents and 1 talent. And he says, okay, invest it. I'm going to come back after a long trip. He comes back. The first guy who is a 5-talent person, he's been given 5 talents because he knew that he was capable to handle that. And he comes back and he says, well done, good and faithful servant. He doubled it. He brought 5 more talents. He says, you have been faithful in little. I will entrust you with much. Enter into the joy of your master. What I love about this story is the guy who comes and has 2 talents is given, and he responds and he invests and he comes back with 2 talents. He says, look, master, what I've done. And he goes, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your master. You have been faithful in little. I will entrust you in much. I love about this story is the 2-talent man didn't have to be a 5-talent person. He had a very specific calling of 2 talents on his life. He didn't have a 5 or 4-talent calling on his life. He was called to be faithful in what God purposed for him. And he's held and he is rewarded with the exact same standard. Oh, Billy Graham, he must be so near the throne room of God. You know, the janitor could be in that same spot in the heavenly realm one day because he was the most faithful janitor who is serving towards God with his whole heart, mind, and soul in the vocation and the calling God gave him as that. I love that about that chapter and that verse. Isaiah, he's a prophet of God in the Old Testament. And in chapter 6, verse 8, we pick up the story and he's somehow eavesdropping on a conversation that the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are having amongst themselves. And the Father says, who shall we send for us? Because God typically uses humans, not angels on occasion. But he typically, plan A is to use humans. We need to send somebody. And Isaiah is there. Come on, pick me, pick me. I'm available. See, that was a pattern of Isaiah's life. God asked him to do some strange things through his life, but he was always available in small things. I'm in the book of Samuel right now in my quiet time. Samuel had to learn the lesson. Here I am, Lord. You see it through all these great men of God and women of God in the Old Testament. Abraham, go to a land that I will show you. Look, I'm just going to give you the marching orders. You're not even going to understand it. I'm not even going to tell you where you go. Think about the life of Joseph. Joseph, faithful in small things. David, a guy who was herding sheep, was then called to different positions to play in the harp in different spots before God felt he was ready to be king. Saul, in his life, he had an amazing road to Damascus experience, but he's told one thing, go and wait in Damascus. And God takes him through the back of the desert to train him up, and he was faithful in small things. Now, why, God, would you choose small things and want us to be faithful in small things first before, why don't you just give us the big assignment? Well, it's because we wouldn't be able to handle it. There's 2 things off the top of my head that I really am firmly, I believe that God uses faithfulness in small things first. And the first one is a maturing process. Paul specifically tells Timothy, he says, do not lay hands on, and the Greek word is neophyte. It's a newbie, a new Christian. Why? He says, because lest he fall into the same trap as the enemy, which was pride, getting puffed up. Hey man, I just got promoted. I'm now a deacon. I'm now whatever. I'm now in charge of this. And it's, as we mentioned last week, I don't need to spend a lot of time on it, but there is nothing like the insidious, devious trickery of pride to get a foothold in our life that the enemy will always use and always has access to our life because of pride. And so he says it must be a process of being faithful as he learns and matures. I often, over the years, have given people opportunities to be faithful in taking out the garbage and different places. And a lot of people just reject it. Oh, I'm beneath that. You see, what God's doing is you're missing out on what God wants to do. He did it with all these great heroes of the faith, giving them faithful opportunities in small things. The degree to which you hear from God is almost always in proportion to the degree that you have obedience in small things. You want to hear from God? Be faithful in what he's already revealed to you, particularly in your quiet time, in the small things. Hey, there's a lying problem in your life. Hey, there's this issue in your life. Take care of that. You want more marching orders? Take care of that first. It's preparation work for your call. Joseph, I mentioned him, but here's a guy who was going to be the prime minister of the most powerful country in that epoch, in that era. And yet God, for 13 years from the age of 17 to 30, had to take him through all kinds of difficulties, being sold into slavery, serving Potiphar, going to jail unjustly, and then spending another 3 years in jail after that, even after he is given the cupbearer that dream. God was preparing him to be faithful in these small things as a maturing process. And the second thing is why I believe that God uses faithfulness in small things in our availability to arc us, to prepare us to hear his call for our primary purpose and calling in our life is to learn submission. Because just like the degree that we learn and hear from God is in direct proportion to our obedience, there is another kind of a saying that God's economy, the degree that you lead is the degree that you are willing and able to submit. I really believe that much of what we go through in life is just simply, especially the difficult things, is just to learn this principle that even in crummy situations with crummy leaders, what God is doing is he's placed these leaders in these situations in your life to see, are you willing to submit? I see it all the time in the world of addictions in particular. First of all, he who has been forgiven much loves much. A lot of guys who have been forgiven and have had victory in the addiction world now end up leading in the addiction world. They haven't been trained to, they haven't taken the Dale Carnegie class, How to Win Friends and Influence People, right? And they've been through struggles and different things and they're a little bit harsher on the outside. And I think God has designed that purposely because what he's looking for is he's looking for the person who's really struggling just to simply go, God, you've put me in this position. I'm going to submit even though I have differences with this person, even though there's better leaders out there. This is the person you put in my life. So you at Feather Sound are really lucky because you got us knuckleheads as leaders. And I think God wants to do a work in your life. Well, I'm speaking for myself, maybe not Doug. But he's teaching us this principle of being available in these small things. And so verse 1, he goes and he describes those leaders that they were submitted to in the church. It says, now in the church at Antioch, there were prophets and teachers. Prophets and teachers. Ephesians chapter 4 says that there were 5 gifts in particular, in addition to prophets and teachers, that God has given as gifts to the church. And he lists them off, and he starts off with that he gave the church apostles. Do we still have capital A apostles, like the original 12? No, that was an office specifically for then. But the Greek word means sent one. The word is an apostle is someone who is called forth for pioneering work. And so you see a lot of missionaries who go off to unreached people groups or church plant and who don't have a lot of direction and oversight. God has created people with an apostolic calling in order to go out and do that work. I think In some ways, the Lord has put an apostolic calling on my life. I like the term apostle, Art, but it's, I don't mean it that way. What I mean is that God has given my heart an entrepreneurial heart, that we looked for years in the missions world to go and plant a church overseas, and we weren't looking if once we realized God was calling us to go off and lead a church, we thought it would be overseas somewhere, but we were looking for an opportunity, if it were in the States, that there would be a reboot or something that would need a little more faith than taking over a larger established church. This apostolic kind of direction. And I think of different people within our fellowship, prophets. It says God, he gave some to be prophets. There was Agabus in the church here in Antioch. Agabus, as we learned a couple weeks ago, he told about that famine that was happening. That's foretelling. Someone who has occasionally divine insights into things that are going to happen in the future. Now, this still happens. We believe that the gifts of the Holy Spirit are still active. We believe that God has set a check mechanism to make sure abuses don't happen, because they do, and they happened in the Old Testament prophets, and I'm going to explain what that check mechanism is a little later. But there's also an element of forthtelling, not just foretelling, but forthtelling, a divine insight into Scripture that you would get into the depths of what God would specifically have to say for Feather Sound Church or whatever fellowship you're part of, and hearing God's word. So a prophetic kind of a word. I look at our group and I see probably Rob Crisp is one of these kind of guys in our leadership team. I see evangelists, Doug Allen, people who have an office. Now, all of us have called to evangelism. We're not called, I'm not an evangelist. Well, no, we're all called to evangelism. Gabe Graham is one of our evangelists in that fivefold gift that he gave Feather Sound Church. Now, we're all called to evangelism, but some have this kind of a calling on their life for that. He gave us also pastors. These are people who have a shepherding heart. I look at our leadership team. Will Baird is one of those guys who has just a shepherding heart for the people and a passion for people. He also gave us teachers, people able to expose the Scripture. And I pray, since this is what I'm doing on a regular basis, that God is cultivating that office in myself. But hear what I love about this church in Antioch as a model. And that's the whole purpose of Acts, is that we would look at it and measure ourselves and going, hey, where do we stand on God's pattern for the church? And what Barnabas and Saul did, well, Barnabas in particular, he cultivated and brought around, starting with Saul, brought around five different guys that had these different giftings and skill set to build up the local church, so that the goal was to divide and replicate. And that's the direction that we, hopefully, Lord willing, are heading on, identifying leaders so that we would divide and replicate and be able to plant around our county and around the world. And he gave them different giftings specifically because he wanted interdependence. There's one area that's a flaw in my abilities that I recognized from the time that we realized that maybe God would call us to be in church leadership. And I begged the Lord, would you give me this gift? And as certainly as I've heard him in Bangkok, Thailand, I heard him in my heart say, I am not going to give you that because I don't want you to be independent. I want you to understand that I'm giving the church different personalities and different giftings, and I want you to rely on those guys and those women and men that you have brought into your church for those giftings, that we need each other. And it says they gave the early church here in Antioch Barnabas. He was a Jew from Cyprus. He was mature. He was the encourager. He was the guy who had an apostolic calling and a pastoral heart. He loved people. The second person that he says that was listed, Simeon, who was called Niger. Simeon is a Hellenized Jewish name. So here's a guy who is a little bit more Greek in his background, but he was also rolled in Roman circles because Niger is a surname that means black, and it was a Roman name. So here's a guy who was in Roman circles, thoroughly Greek, a little bit less Jewish, but a Jewish background, and Lucius of Cyrene. Lucius of Cyrene. He probably was led to the Lord. Maybe Simeon was the evangelist, because most scholars believe that this guy Simeon was Simon of Cyrene, the one who carried the cross of Jesus after Jesus was beaten to a pulp, couldn't take it up. And so they called this man to do it, and he carries him up. This guy's probably watching all the events, decides that Jesus must be the Messiah. And again, that's conjecture. You don't need to write a book on it, but it seems logical. And it says that Simon of Cyrene, you would have guaranteed that these guys would have known each other, being from the same background and same place. I mean, look around. You have the Sons of Italy Lodge. You have the Hungarian Lodge. You have all these different groups, the German club, the Italian club, all these different groups. They all hang out together still to this day. It was no different in those days. So he was probably the evangelist, bringing this guy in. Simeon, Lucius, Manaim. Now, here's an interesting fella. Manaim was, it says here that he was raised with Herod, but the Greek word actually means foster brother. Here's a guy who didn't just grow up down the road from him. Hey, we went to elementary school together. Here's a guy who actually grew up in Herod's household. This is Herod the Tetrarch, the one who decapitated John the Baptist. He was the one who interrogated Jesus before he was went to the cross. And what I find fascinating, again, I think it's logical to assume, I again wouldn't write a book on it, but here's a guy who was so tight and so close to Herod, Manaim. He's growing up with him. There is no reason not to think that he wasn't some sort of advisor. He could have very well have been next to him, and at the party where John the Baptist loses his head, we could have been there while he's being interrogated and Jesus is not answering. For sure, he's around and observing all these incredible things that are happening around the passion of the Christ, Jesus going to the cross, the veil being torn with a Manaim. He's got a Jewish background name. And so how do you go from being high society, highly educated in royalty, and now becoming the local leader of a small church in Antioch? And I think it was a matter of he was witness to the very same things that Herod the Tetrarch was witness to. One hardened his heart, and one opened himself up to the possibilities that Jesus truly was the Messiah, that Jesus really did what he said he would do. And I pray that as we move through this, if you don't know Jesus and you've not considered who he is, there's two choices. You can harden your heart to who he is, or you can soften your heart and you could go with intellectual honesty and you could say, I really want to know the truth. Is this really the Son of God, the one who died for our sins, or is he just a madman? Those are good questions to ask. And the Bible makes it very clear that if you seek him, you will find him. So I plead with you, Jesus is the Son of God, but don't harden your heart like Herod. Herod had a definite end. For the believer, we're going to sit down with him one day and we're going to say, Manaim, tell me, man, how did it happen? How did you go from the royal palace to being one of the elders at one of the first major church plants? Tell me the story, man. And we're going to hear that. And the last person that was listed, very interesting that he's listed last, is Saul. The word Saul, the name Saul, means requested one. Here's the guy who was the up-and-coming rising star of the Sanhedrin. Everyone knew him. He was the most educated, the best speaker, the guy who was the most passionate. Again, the rising star. And now he was the most qualified, and he's listed last. In fact, God, right from the beginning, took him through a long period of humbling, educating him for 3 years, Galatians says, on the backside of the desert, taking him to Jerusalem. They don't know what to do with him, so they send him back home to Tarsus. And then Barnabas, years later, seeks him out. And he's listed last among these people. But that's about to change. There is a humbling, because God wanted him to ark. God wanted him to be available and faithful in small things. What I also love about this in the early church is that Jesus has a great job of tearing down prejudices, preconceived notions. You got royalty hanging out with a guy who is a Jew from Cyprus, a Levite, a former background, a guy who was a highfalutin Pharisee, and this black fella from North Africa, two men from North Africa, and the prejudice in the gospel is torn down. That's amazing. And verse 2, so the A, available. Verse 2, as they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called him. Note that after these people were faithful in small things, going on their short-term mission trips and different things like that, leading in the local church, there were two specific activities that were the context by which the Holy Spirit spoke his calling. And these are very, very significant. The first one, and my R in ARC, available. The second one is reorientation. Reorientation. What I mean by that is there is a process that God wants before he speaks his purpose and calling in people's life, is to take your heart off of the flesh and move it into the spirit. How do you do that? Because God's not going to give people a call who are walking according to the flesh. Here's what he does. He does two things, or expects two things, in the arcing of our life, the reorientation. The first one is they ministered to the Lord. They ministered to the Lord. The word here, letargeo, it means specifically in classical Greek, it's the guy who by voluntarily at his own expense placed himself in political leadership. So in the British system, we have the prime minister and you have different ministers, minister of finance, minister of resources, whatever. That's the word that's used here. It's very closely tied to the latreia, the word in the Greek that is the priestly duties that happen. So the idea here is very clear what the New Testament Greek has done. It's taken that classical word and it's redefined it as someone who is the CSB says they worshiped, but it doesn't quite you don't understand the fullness of it. It's ministering. And what the word became to be understood as anything that you do that is Godward. So I could help, as I've often said, a little old lady across the street, and I could do that for myself. I want to do this for my honor. Or I could do it to the Lord. So a lot of times people, they want honor, and so they do good things because it's for themselves. But the Greek word here, this is what I want to be very clear. It says that they ministered to the Lord. It doesn't say they ministered for the Lord. And so there's three things you can do. You can minister for the Lord, meaning I'm trying to earn something, and so I'm doing it for you, Lord. Look what I'm doing. Or I'm doing it for myself, trying to build my self-esteem up or something. Hey, I'm a pretty good person. Or you can minister to the Lord. I'm saying this because I really want us to understand this. Is that when I minister to the Lord, anything I do can be worship. It just differentiates if it's for or to. Am I taking the garbage out for my wife to please her, or am I doing this to the Lord? Am I doing this as worship? What I love the fact is that anything I do can be worship. Cleaning, making dinner, serving my boss well at work. Anything can be worship. It speaks to motives. Who's it to? In Romans chapter 12, it says, because you recognize the mercies and the blessings of God, offer your bodies as living sacrifices. Here's my living sacrifice. Here's my life, which is your logical latreia, your logical worship. It means this is your only logical response to what God has done. And it says this in the NIV, it's translated, and it says, this is your spiritual act of worship. It's the same understanding right here, is that worship can be anything. It doesn't just mean standing here listening to Jake and the worship team and singing. It doesn't mean setting up in the morning or greeting out there, because that stuff doesn't have to be worship. It could be doing it for yourself. Hey, look at the people. Look at me. I'm serving at the church. I've gave up my morning. It's who it's done to. And the motive is for God. It's towards God. We understand that, right? This is really, really important. I have mentioned this months ago, but I'm rereading it. I reread it in a book just recently that I was reading, and it talked about Eric Little, the guy in the Chariots of Fire movie, real story. What impacted me and radically transformed the way I had an outlook in life is the section where this guy who doesn't run on Sunday in the 40s Olympics, and he doesn't run on Sunday because he wants to honor the Lord. He's doing his running to the Lord. God, I want to worship you in this. And right before the race, his sister says, what are you doing this for? You're supposed to be a missionary. And he says, look, I know that God's called me to be a missionary, but he also made me fast. And I feel God's good pleasure when I run. See, here's a guy who completely understood that anything could be worship, even running. And so that's the idea of reorienting yourself. The two things they did, they ministered to the Lord, not for the Lord. And so here, the context is you have these Barnabas and Saul and these other leaders, and they were serving God in worship. Some of them were teaching Sunday school, and some of them were teaching a class and whatever, volunteering in the children's ministry and serving in worship and teaching, but it was all ministering. He doesn't list a number of things. He doesn't go and say, this is how they were ministering, because he doesn't have to, because anything can be worship. I think I beat this dead horse. I can move on. But the second thing that they were doing in Acts chapter 13, verse 2, is they were fasting. Matthew chapter 6, verse 16 says, Jesus' own words, it says, and when you fast, this is New Testament, Jesus speaking, and when you fast, he doesn't say, if you fast, on occasion, if you think about it. No, he gives a bunch of listing, assuming that this is something that we are going to do. Why? What's so great about fasting? Not something that we talk about very often, but if you dive into the spiritual, the physical aspects of fasting, let me go on a kind of a tirade, I guess you could say. I want to speak about the blessings of it. I love science. I'm a bit of a science geek. But one of the things, if you dive into the world of fasting, and they didn't know this up until primarily the last decade, but there's all kinds of processes that are affected. Your insulin levels, your ability to lose weight, the ability for that affects your memory, your leptin levels. I could go on and on scientifically, but it all comes down to a process called autophagy, which means self-eating. See, what happens is because of our lifestyles and the toxins that come in because of what we breathe and the different things that we introduce into our lives and the crummy food that we eat, your cells are deteriorating because we live in a cursed world. And so there's all kinds of junk that enter into our cells and into our system. But God assumes, because he has commanded us, because he built our bodies, that we will fast. And what happens after 18 hours reaches its peak after 2 days to 3 days. This process of self-eating, what your good cells do is they attack the bad cells and the dying cells and the junk, and they start to consume that. But it only happens after 18 hours. All right, now's the scientific reason behind it. It's good for you. You fast once, you're not going to really feel the effects. It's something that we're called to do. You live by faith, knowing the science behind it. This is established and proven. But spiritually, what happens is that fasting is a reversal of the natural pattern of living for the gratification of the flesh. See, that's what we do, is we're oriented to eating and to living after our appetites. And God says, I want to reverse that, starving the flesh that we might feed the spirit. And it takes discipline, something that is greatly lacking in North America. And as we do that, we begin to experience great spiritual victories in our life. You see, what we're saying is, God, you're more important to me than something that is absolutely critical in my life, food. Now, some people, because of this cursed world and are diabetic, they can't do it. But I would encourage, there's other ways to fast. And I think most people should consider fasting. But the result is we can get rid of something that we need or that has a stronghold in our life. I think the Facebook, social media are something that would be a good thing. It's the idea is something that is significant. And so I think the answer, why we don't arc, why don't we hear God's voice, is because we have two problems. There's either sin in our life. The Psalms say, if I cherish sin in my life, you would not have heard me. 1 Peter chapter 3 says, the way I treat my spouse direct that directly impacts how God hears my prayers. James chapter 5 says, confess your sins so that the prayer of faith might heal you. Sin is a specific blocker of hearing God's voice and his direction in our life. But also, on top of that, a casual approach to our relationship with God. I am not speaking at any moment during this message at all about salvation. Salvation is by grace through faith alone. It's a matter of confessing and believing in your heart that Jesus is Lord and you will be saved. Lots of people are entering into the kingdom of God based just on, of course, everyone is entering just based on that, but having no reward past that. And it's because they have not taken a specific, determined path towards knowing and hearing how God is speaking. And so we take a casual approach, and that's why they included as the second thing that they did in Acts chapter 13 was fasting. And Paul tells us in Philippians 3:19 the problem, because their God is their bellies, meaning the appetites. I would rather feed the flesh than the spirit. Just simple. Now, we don't go after these things in order to obtain our salvation. We have it. We do it because we have salvation. Now I have discipline in my life. I want to pursue you, God, because I really want to know your plan for my life. But it doesn't happen with casual Christianity. It's a sacrifice fasting. I'll just say one thing on that. I think that one of the things that we do is when we fast, you have to understand the stages. First time I fasted for 3 days in college, and I went to a buffet afterwards. It was like the stupidest thing anyone could ever do. Never gonna fast ever again. But understanding the stages, the first day and the second day, I typically have a terrible headache. I just gotta accept it. I have a headache because you're having withdrawals from caffeine and sugars and carbs. And the third day is a little better. If you finish there, then great. If you go on longer, there seems to be a pause in that, and then it comes back harder. But understanding those stages, understanding how to do it, how to come off the fast, and I'll just leave it at that. There's lots of online stuff to help you fast if you're feeling convicted on that. And verse 2, I only have one more point, so I am coming in for a landing. As they were worshiping the Lord, the Holy Spirit spoke, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them." This is setting them apart, consecrating. I have to fix my screened-in porch because of the hurricane blew a screen out. And what I do is I'm going to go grab the tools that I need for fixing that screened-in porch, and I'm going to set them apart. I'm going to clean them and prepare them, put them in my bucket so that I can then go and repair it. That's how the Holy Spirit spoke. Now I'm setting you apart for consecration, for preparation, getting you ready to go to my calling that I have for you. There's a specific work for everyone, and he equips the called. He doesn't call the equipped. He's going to separate you and consecrate you and prepare you. So they were ministering to the Lord, fasting in a concerted effort, and the Holy Spirit spoke. I don't know how it happened. Maybe Agabus spoke. But there's a subjectiveness in understanding. Why? Because I believe that God wants us to rule our life by faith. But here's the problem. Even if it was Agabus coming and saying, "Art, I heard a calling. You're supposed to go to Zimbabwe." And even in the middle of that, there is something that happens. Or if it was just an impression in my quiet time. What he wants is not for us to jump out and go. The third point in arcing is confirmation. Verse 3. Then after they fasted, prayed, and laid hands on them, they sent them off. This is the fail-safe mechanism that God has put in place. What they did is to verify it, they have fasted. All right, let's fast again. What do you mean? We already fasted. I heard God's voice clearly. He spoke. Now I'm going to fast to clarify it. I'm going to go to my spiritual leaders and those that are mighty men and women of my life. I'm going to say, hey, this is how I believe the Lord is leading in my life. Does that resonate with you? Because there is a ton of people who went and were not sent. And one of the reasons we have a policy where you can't go on the missions field for 9 months after you went on a short-term mission trip, because we don't want people welling up with emotion and going off. We want to know that we're consecrated and set apart for these things. And so they prayed and they fasted again. Typically no Damascus Road experiences. Verse 4. So being sent out by the Holy Spirit, they went down to Seleucia. There they sailed to Cyprus. Arriving in Salamis, they proclaimed the word of God in the Jewish synagogues, and they had John as their assistants. The Holy Spirit gave direction, but they stepped out in faith to Cyprus. It was a logical place to go. Barnabas was from there. John Mark was from there originally. They had roots there. They understood the culture. They understand there was a need. The worship of Venus was happening in Cyprus. And if you were a woman on the entire island, at some point in your life, you had to serve at least once in Venus's temple as a prostitute. Can you imagine? Every woman. I mean, this is a place that was dark and needed Jesus. But in missions, the need is not the call. The need should be something that should ask us to pray about the need. The need is not the call. The need should cause us to pray about whether it is the call. There's an opening in children's ministry. Lord, is that you calling? Is that me? We don't want someone who's going to help in children's ministry if that's not where God is leading them. But you should be praying about it. There's a need here. There's a need, hey, getting involved in addiction ministries and different things like that. God, I hear about this need. Is this where you would have me? That's part of being available. And allowing the confirmation of the call. And they went to Cyprus because the Lord confirmed that. I believe that every single one of us has a calling. It's going to look different. Some of you, God is calling to stay in the job and the position that God has called you to stay in. And he wants to use you in a more dramatic way, but he wants to be able to reorient your priorities and the vision that you have for your life. It ties into the message last week, submission. Am I willing to put myself under the mission that God has for my life? God, here, I'm going to join your mission. I'll tell you what, the whole central purpose of that book, Man in the Mirror, my experience and what I've seen in so many people's lives as a missions pastor is that when people submit themselves to the calling that God has on their life, it always looks a lot different, or most of the time looks a lot different. But it is far better when we reorder, not according to our emotions, but according to God's calling on our life. So if that's you today, I want to pray for you. That if you really sincerely would like to know the calling of God on your life, and it's typically, again, going to be where you are, but are you available to go overseas? Are you available to be used and sent wherever God wants you to go? I think that's the question. What I want most of all for our people is to understand the joy of being arced, being available, reorienting your life, having a confirmation, and knowing the central purpose, at least for this season of your life, that God has for you. So, Lord, we come before you. We thank you for Barnabas and Saul and this early church and the pattern that you set up. I believe specifically that Luke included verse 1 through 4 specifically as a pattern, as a guideline for us simply to learn how to hear your voice and to know your direction that you have for us. Thank you for salvation. I thank you that it's not complicated, but it is by faith that we surrender our life. But I also thank you, Lord, that it's by faith that we trust in you and believe and act on that, knowing that you have a call. Thank you, Lord, so much for the people that I've seen around here at Feather Sound that are operating according to your calling and operating in joy in the middle of that. We pray, God, that you would speak this morning as people respond and hear your voice and want to know it. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. I had a whole bunch more to say, but I skipped it. And if you ever want to know, just call me and I'll give you the extended version. We have a prayer team up front. We'd love to pray for you. Otherwise, have a super blessed Sunday and a tremendous Thanksgiving. We have a whole lot to be thankful for, right? All kinds of issues, but in the middle of that, we have a lot to be thankful for. Amen.